Hello guys, this is Pirates of Medicine, and in today's video we are going to study and cover the anatomy base for Croc 1 exam. In today's video we are going to cover as many questions as we can, and we'll try to stick to the fundamentals and basics of anatomy and solve the questions using that knowledge as well. So let's begin. So the first question we have here is about a 10-year-old child who complains of weakness, nausea and irritability. Helminths of white color and 5 to 10 millimeter long were found on the underwear. On microscopy of the scrape from the perianal folds, achromic ovums of unsymmetrical form were revealed. So we need to indicate what helminth is parasitating on the child. So the elements you should notice or observe in this question is the morphology of the helminth. So here we can see that the helminth is of white color, about 5 to 10 millimeter long, and it drops achromic ovums in the perianal region, correct? The perianal region is the region surrounding the anus. So what we have here is an infection of the Entrobius vermicularis. Entrobius vermicularis, also known as pinworm, causes the disease called as entrobiasis, or specifically perianal pruritus. So as we can see, the site of infection of Entrobius vermicularis is the ileocecal region of the gut, where they attach to the mucosa. But these parasites, they can wander out through the intestines towards the stomach or towards the rectum, and the fertilized female worms can migrate out through the anus and deposit egg on the perianal region. So as you can see here, the diagnostic method of diagnosing Entrobius infection is by taking a scotch tape putting the scotch tape on around the perianal region of the patient and obtaining the perianal scrape, and then observing the specimen under a microscope. So this is the worm when observed under the microscope. As you can see, its tail is pointed like a pin, so this is why it is called a pin worm. So clinical manifestations, like the manifestations of this infection in the body, include intense perianal itching, which is called as pruritus emi, and the patient tend to vigorously scratch themselves attempting to relieve the itching, and they can cause skin damage, bleeding, and as the region is prone to bacterial sites, so they can cause infection and again intensified itching. Other symptoms can be anorexia, insomnia, nightmares, bedwetting, which are secondary symptoms which occur due to the itching itself. So the treatment of choice for such helminths is mebendazole, which is the drug used for this helminth infection. But also abendazole, levimazole and parenteral palmate are also effective. So I think that clears the question why the answer is perianal, why the answer is Entrobius vermicularis, because the scrape from the perianal fold reveals achromic eggs, and which are characteristic of Entrobius vermicularis itself. So let's go to the second question. The second question is interesting. A patient has been brought to the hospital with the complaints of headache, pain in the left hypochondrium. He has been ill for 1.5 weeks. The sudden illness began with the increase of body temperature up to 39.9 degrees Celsius. In 3 hours, the temperature decreased and hydropyrosis began. The attacks repeat rhythmically in 48 hours. The patient has visited one African country. The doctors have suspected malaria. What method of laboratory diagnostic is necessary to use? So, couple of things we need to notice here is hydropyrosis means the sweating phase. There is intensive sweating, and The other thing we need to notice is that the doctors have already suspected malaria. So let's talk a little about malaria itself for having a basic knowledge of the disease. So malaria is a parasitic disease caused by Plasmodium protozoa, correct? And the vector of this Plasmodium protozoa is the Anopheles mosquito, the female Anopheles specifically. So what are the clinical manifestations of malaria? Malaria is characterized by a unique paroxysm of fever, shaking, chills and sweats. The patients with malaria typically become symptomatic a few weeks after the infection. So after the prodromal period ends, the infection period starts, and the characteristic manifestation of malaria is that there are paroxysms of fever. So what are these paroxysms of fever? Like every 48 or 72 hours, depending on the species of the Plasmodium, there is a recurring or repeating three-stage manifestation. First, it begins with a period of shivering and chills, which lasts for approximately 1-2 hours, and then the second stage comes, which is followed by a high fever. Then the patient finally has a stage of excessive sweating, which is excessive diaphoresis, and then the body temperature drops to normal. And after a few hours or few days, this cycle repeats. So other symptoms include cough, fatigue, malaise, arthralgia, which is the inflammation of joints or pain in the joints specifically, and myalgia, which is pain in the muscles. So why do these paroxysms occur? The answer to this question is in the life cycle of the malaria. So as you can see, the malaria Plasmodium has a part of life cycle in the mosquito and a part of life cycle in the human. In human, the parasite goes into the hepatocytes and it has a cycle in the erythrocytes. So the fever and the chills of malaria are associated with the rupture of erythrocytic stage schizones. So as you can see, first of all, when the Anopheles mosquito injects the sporozoites into the human, the sporozoites go into the hepatocytes, they multiply, and then they are released. When they are released, they are called as merocytes. Then they go into the RBCs. RBC stage, they have trophozoites. Then there is a schizone stage in the RBCs. And then the schizones rupture. And when they rupture, they release a toxic substance called as hemozoin. This hemozoin is the reason which causes these characteristic chills, which reoccur every 3-4 days in malaria. So the erythrocytic cycle is different in different types of Plasmodium species. For example, in falciparum, it is 36-48 hours. In vivax, it is 48 hours. In ovale, it is 48 hours. And in Plasmodium malaria, it is 72 hours. So this duration of the erythrocytic cycle is the reason that the chills are either 48 hours or 72 hours. The periods of paroxysm are different in different types of malaria infection. So after learning about the manifestations, we need to go to the diagnosis. So the golden standard for malaria diagnosis is microscopy of the blood smear. We take the blood from the patient and we observe the blood under a microscope. And the different stages of the Plasmodium have different characteristic appearance under the microscope. So if we observe any of these characteristic like malarial Plasmodium cells or abnormal cells in the blood, like other than the blood cells, we can say that the patient is affected with malaria, and it is the reason that the paroxysms are being manifested in the patient. So the gold standard is microscopy of the blood smear. And now after diagnosis, we need to treat the patient. And the most common anti-malarial drugs include chloroquine phosphate, which in common language we also called as chingamin. So chingamin or chloroquine phosphate is the anti-malarial drug of choice. Other anti-malarials can include atovaquone, progonaline, quinine sulfate, doxycycline, and primaquine phosphate. Third question we have today is slime blood protozoa 30 to 200 microns of length have been revealed in a man's feces. The body is covered with cilia and has a correct oval form with little bit narrowed forward and wide round shaped back end. On the forward end, a mouth is visible. In the cytoplasm, there are two nucleuses and two short vacuoles. For whom are the described attributes typical? So this is again a question of parasitology and specifically morphology of the parasites. So what to observe here is the description of the protozoa itself. The protozoa is 30 to 200 microns of length and it has cilia and an oval shape. Another thing to notice is that there are two nucleuses and two short vacuoles. Now, all these morphological features are typical for Balanitidium coli. So let's talk about Balanitidium coli. So Balanitidium coli is a parasite of intestines in humans. It causes balanitidiasis, also known as balanitidiosis. This is the morphological picture of the parasite. This is the trophozoite form and this is the cyst. As you can see, there are two vacuoles, the cystome and the contractile vacuole, and there is a micronucleus and a macronucleus, and the whole organism is covered with cilia. So the site of infection of Balanitidium coli, from the name coli, is in the large intestine, from the cecum to the rectum. So what does it cause in a patient? So from the question itself, there is slime and blood in the feces. So Balanitidium coli infection causes ciliary dysentery. There is intermittent diarrhea alternating with constipation, and the individuals with high balanitidiasis may have mucoid and bloody stools, which we saw in the patient in the respected question. So the treatment for this protozoa or any protozoa is metronidazole, which is the drug of choice. And also we can use tetracycline or idoquinol. So I think this clears the question. So the next question we have is about the heart. A patient in 3 weeks after acute myocardial infarction, there has been an infarction in the heart, has pain in the heart and joints and pneumonia. What is the mechanism of the development of post-infarction Dressler syndrome? So they have given us the symptoms, the clinical manifestations, which include heart, joint, pain, and pneumonia. And they have also given the diagnosis, which is the Dressler syndrome. But they have asked the manifestation or the pathophysiology of the Dressler syndrome itself. Let's talk about Dressler syndrome a bit. So after a myocardial infarction occurs, myocardial infarction is the death of the cardiac tissue because of inavailability of oxygen, because the blood supply can be compromised. So if there is, for example, a thrombosis of the coronary artery of the heart, so there can be a blockage of a part of heart supply. So this leads to myocardial infarction. Part of the cardiac tissue becomes like it dies because of there is not enough oxygen for it to survive. And this is known as myocardial infarction. So there are the thing about myocardial infarction is that the heart, the skeletal muscles and the nerves are the three main tissues which are not regenerative. So if a myocardial infarction occurs and a part of heart dies, it doesn't regenerate. That part of the heart which is dead is eaten up by the body's own immune system, and it is replaced by connective tissue. So what is done here, correct? So what is Drusler's syndrome? So as I was talking to you about what happens in infarction, then that part of the heart which is covered by connective tissue later, so it is a physiological change, like if not physiological, but it is the compensation of the infarction, correct? If the infarction has occurred, the dead tissue needs to be replaced, so connective tissue takes its place. But what happens in Drusler syndrome is that the body's own autoimmune system attacks the pericardium of the heart. So it is an autoimmune, it is autoimmune in etiology when the myocardial antibodies cause an inflammatory reaction in the pericardium or the other layers of the heart. So it is a post-myocardial infarction syndrome in the form which occurs in the form of secondary pericarditis, and there can be pericardial effusion or not, and other symptoms are fever, because it is an inflammatory response, there can be fever, malaise, leukocytes are increased, and the ESR is increased, which is, ESR is a non-specific marker of inflammation. So Drusler syndrome is an inflammatory response, so this is why ESR is increased. So the thing to note here is that Drusler syndrome is autoimmune in etiology, correct? So it is an autoimmune syndrome and it causes an inflammatory reaction. So the treatment of choice is anti-inflammatory NSAIDs, and colchicine is also used with the NSAIDs. So like the question said, what is the etiology or what is the mechanism of development? So it is autoimmune inflammation. That's all we need to know here. Okay, this is the most famous question in anatomy base. So during the fetal period of the development in the vascular system of the fetus, the large arterial duct, Botello's duct, is functioning, which converts into ligament arteriosum after birth. What anatomical formation does this duct connect with each other? So we have this famous duct called as ductus arteriosus or the Botello's duct. Botello's duct is named after the Italian physiologist Leonardo Botello, and it is the duct which occurs in the developing fetus. So in the developing fetus, ductus arteriosus connects the pulmonary arteries trunk with the proximal descending aorta, correct? So what it does, what is the function of this duct in the fetus? It allows most of the blood from the right ventricle to bypass the fetus blood fluid filled non-functioning lungs. So in normal heart, we have the double circulation where the blood goes from the right ventricle to the lungs and then to the pulmonary artery. The pulmonary vein brings back into the left atrium and the left ventricle pushes the blood to the body. But in fetus where the lungs are not functioning, there is no need to for the blood to go to the lungs through the pulmonary artery. So what the ductus arteriosus does is it connects the pulmonary artery and it directly to the descending aorta. So after the fetus has grown and the baby is born, after normal gestation, this duct closes at the birth and it becomes the ligament arteriosum or the arterial ligament. But there are some cases where this duct can be open even after the birth. So this case or this specific case is known as patent ductus arteriosus or PDA, in which there is a persistent communication between the descending thoracic aorta and the pulmonary artery. So you think yourself, a duct which is supposed to bypass the pulmonary artery directly to the thoracic, to the descending aorta, because the lungs are not functioning and there is no need to for the oxygenation of blood through the fetal lungs because the mother is doing this work through the placenta. Here, when oxygenated blood or deoxygenated blood specifically comes into the right ventricle, get pushed up into the pulmonary artery. Now there is a patent duct present which can throw this deoxygenated blood directly into the aorta. So this will cause circulation disorders. There won't be efficient blood circulation in this case. So this can cause many like hypoxic disorders or cardiac disorders. So the treatment of patent ductus arteriosus is surgery, surgical treatment for the closure of this duct, and this is how this condition, congenital condition, is treated. So the thing to note here is that the Botello's duct or ductus arteriosus connects the trunk of pulmonary artery to the proximal descending aorta in a developing fetus. So pulmonary artery and aorta. Correct? Good. Let's go to the sixth. Okay. So question from the gym itself. So a young man felt sharp pain in the back during active tightening on the horizontal bar. So objectively, there is a pain while moving the upper extremity. There is limited pronation and adduction function. Sprain of what muscle is present? So what we need to know here is that there is a pain in the back. So if there is a pain in the back, there is a, if there is a muscle damage or muscle sprain, then the, if the pain is in the back, then it must be a muscle of the back that is sprained. Correct. And then they have given us the function of the muscle that is affected. So there is pain while moving the upper extremity, limited pronation and adduction of the upper extremity, specifically the shoulder joint. So there is a disorder or like injury or sprain of the muscle of the back, which has the function, which functions to move the upper extremity in an adduction and pronation manner. Correct. So for understanding the movements in anatomy, let's do a small talk about the movements. Let's talk about adduction and abduction first. So adduction is the movement of a limb towards the midline of the body. So you see this hand, if this good lady here moves the hand back to the her near her legs, lower limb, it is called as adduction. But if this good lady moves her hand away from the midline, this is the midline, if she moves her hands away from the midline, it is called as abduction. Correct? Towards the midline we have adduction, and away from the midline we have abduction. Then we have flexion and extension. Flexion and extension are the same thing, but they occur in a like different plane. So if this good lady moves this hand backwards away from the midline or away from this line backwards, this is known as extension. But if she moves her good hands away from the midline towards her face, towards the ventral side of the body in this salute, which I shouldn't name, but you all know what I'm talking about, is called as flexion. Correct. So this is flexion and extension. Then we have the external and internal rotation, which we also known as pronation and supination. In external rotation, for example, this is the external rotation and internal rotation in the elbow joint. Internal rotation is towards the midline and external rotation is to outwards of the midline, away from the midline. Similarly, here we have in this plane, external rotation is towards the dorsal side of the body, and internal rotation is back to the lower part of the body. And here we have horizontal abduction and adduction. So away from the midline we have abduction, and towards the midline we have adduction. The same rule, guys. Correct? Good. Now let's come to the back, to the muscle of the back. I told you that there was sharp pain in the back, so it must be muscles of the back. So let's cover the basic muscles of the back. So in the back we have two layers of the muscles. There are superficial muscles and the deep muscles. F- from the name you can realize that the superficial muscles are located like superficially and the deep muscles are located deep inside the back. Correct. So the first important muscle of the back we have here is the trapezius muscle. So the trapezius muscle is a muscle near the neck and the upper back region. So what is its function? It elevates, rotates and retracts the scapula. So its function is basically elevation, rotation and retraction of the scapula. Correct. Then we have the latissimus dorsalis muscle. What are its functions? Note that the function of latissimus dorsalis muscle are adduction, medial pronation, extension of humerus from a flexed position. So latissimus dorsalis is a muscle of the lower back and a tendon of this muscle extends in and inserts into the humerus. So latissimus dorsalis function are adduction, medial pronation and extension of the humerus. Then we have the rhomboid major and minor, which again retract the scapula. Then we have the levator scapulae. From the name itself, this elevates the scapula and extends and flexes the head laterally. And then we have the serratus posterior, superior and inferior muscles. And these muscles act on the ribs. And they are the muscles of thorax, which acts on the ribs. Then we have the deep muscles. Now the deep muscles are the muscles of the back which are around the vertebral column. So the main function of these muscles is either holding the trunk erect or the movement of the spine. So first we have the splenius capitis and cervicis muscles. So these muscles are located below the trapezius muscles in the neck region, and their function is movement of the head and the neck. They aid in the movement of head and the neck with other muscles of the neck, like sternocleidomastoid, etc. Then we have the lateral tract and the medial tract muscles. So these muscles are around the vertebral column. They hold the trunk erect, extend and rotate the spine. They work on the spine. Then we have the intertransverse muscles, which flex the spine laterally, and the interspinal muscles, which are in the vertebral column, which fixes the spine at the position needed. So back to the question, guys. Here we have that we derived the question that there is a sharp pain in the back and the functions are movement of upper extremity, limited pronation and adduction function. So levator scapulae, we know it elevates the scapula and aids in the movement of the head. Rhomboid major retracts the scapula. Trapezius elevates the scapula and basically movement of the scapula. And then we have subscapularis. Now latissimus dorsi and subscapularis are the only muscles in these options which have the similar function of movement of upper extremity, limited pronation and adduction function. But the thing to note here is that the subscapular muscle is a muscle of shoulder joint. It is a muscle located in the shoulder joint region. It has the functions of adduction and medial pronation, but it cannot be the answer here because the patient has sharp pain in the back, not in the shoulder. So the muscle in question which is injured should be latissimus dorsi. Clear? Good. Okay, now we have a question from the lymphoid region of anatomy. The children have a heavy nasal breathing resulting from excessive development of lymphoid tissue of pharyngeal mucous membrane. So what tonsils growth may cause this effect? So they have given a couple of four of these tonsils. These all are the tonsils which we'll study now. So tonsils. So humans are born with four types of tonsils. The pharyngeal tonsils, which is one, the two tubal tonsils, two palatine tonsils and the lingual tonsils. So these tonsils are located in the nasopharynx or the like region around the nasopharynx or oropharynx, and they form a ringed arrangement called as Waldeyer's ring. So they form a Waldeyer's ring in the throat. So So let's cover these tonsils one by one. So first we have lingual tonsil. So these are the lymphoid nodules located in the submucosa of posterior two-thirds of the tongue. So there are many of these lingual tonsils located in the posterior third of the tongue's submucosa. So then we have the pharyngeal tonsil, which refers to the collection of lymphoid tissue in the mucosa of the roof of nasopharynx. The pharyngeal are located in the mucosa of the roof of the nasopharynx. And the thing to notice is that these tonsils are quite often enlarged, and when they are enlarged, they are known as adenoids. Correct. So then we have the two tubal tonsils, which are the lymphoid tissue around the opening of the eustachian tubule in the lateral wall of the nasopharynx. Then we have the palatine tonsils, which are located near the palates, in the oropharynx wall, between the palatoglossal arc and the palatopharyngeal arc posteriorly. So pharyngeal tonsils are located in the mucosa of the roof of the nasopharynx, tubal tonsils in the lateral wall near the opening of eustachian tube, lingual tonsils in the posterior third of the tongue, and the palatine tonsils in the palatoglossal arc or the palatopharyngeal arc, basically near the palatine region. Correct. So these are the regions of the buccal cavity where these tonsils are present. In the question, there is excessive development of the lymphoid tissue of pharyngeal mucous membrane. So pharyngeal mucous membrane is there is excessive development, which I told you is very common and is called as adenoids. So this occurs in pharyngeal tonsils. Okay, so next question is that in a course of laparotomy, a surgeon revealed gangrenous lesion of the descending colon. So this was caused by thrombosis of the following artery. They have given a couple of arteries. Now, what we need to know is that thrombosis is the clot formation in an artery. So when a clot formation in an artery occurs, it can cause ischemia of an organ. So ischemia of an organ leads to necrosis or gangrene formation in an organ. Correct. So what happens here is that whatever artery supplies an organ, for example, let's say that the coronary artery supplies the heart. Correct. So if the coronary artery is damaged, or there is a thrombosis of the coronary artery, the plaque formation in the coronary artery, there is a chance that myocardial infarction can occur. Now, myocardial infarction is a series of necrotic changes. What is gangrenous lesion? Gangrenous lesion occurs in the part of the body that communicates with the outer environment. As you know that the oral cavity and the anal cavity are the two holes in which the GIT can communicate with the outer environment. So the gangrenes can occur in such tracts which communicate directly with the environment. Correct. So there is a gangrenous lesion of the descending colon. So there is thrombosis of an artery. So as there is a lesion of the descending colon, there must be a thrombosis of the artery which supplies the descending colon. So to cover all the bases in this topic, let's understand the blood supply of the large intestine. So the foregut region, which we all know is part of the small intestine, and then we have the small intestine basically, then we have the midgut, so the foregut, then we have the midgut, and then we have the hindgut. And midgut, it covers the ileocecal region, the region where ileum of the small intestine meets with the cecum of the large intestine, then the cecum and the vermiform vadix to the proximal two-thirds of the transverse colon. And then we have the hindgut, from the remaining one-third part of the transverse colon to the sigmoid colon. So the foregut is supplied by the celiac artery. The small intestine is supplied by branches of the celiac artery. The midgut region, which I told you is from the ileocecal junction to the two-thirds first part of the transverse colon, receives supply from the branches of superior mesenteric artery. And then the hindgut. The hindgut, the remaining part till the sigmoid colon, is supplied by the inferior mesenteric artery. So the first part of the intestine, small intestine by the celiac artery, the midgut by the superior mesenteric artery, and the hindgut by the inferior mesenteric artery. In the diagram, you can see here that this part from the vermiform appendix to the transverse colon, this is the ascending colon, correct? So this part is the part of the midgut. From here, vermiform appendix to the proximal two-thirds of the transverse colon. This part is the midgut. In this part, this is the ascending colon, then the two-thirds of the transverse colon, correct? So these are supplied by branches of the superior mesenteric artery. So what branches? We have the ileocolic artery, which supplies the ascending colon, a part of ascending colon. Then we have the right colic artery, which supplies the main part of the ascending colon. Then we have the middle colic artery, which supplies the two-thirds of the transverse colon, and a small branch called as marginal artery. Then we have the inferior mesenteric artery, whose branch left colic artery supplies the descending colon, and the sigmoid branches supply the sigmoid colon. So here we can see that the descending colon, the colon in question here, is supplied by the branch of inferior mesenteric artery called as the left colic artery, or in the Latin we called as sinister colic artery, correct? So sinister colic is the answer, because it is the artery that supplies the descending colon. The middle colic artery supplies the two-thirds of the transverse colon. Here you can see middle colic artery supplying the two-thirds of the colon, proximal two-thirds. The right colic artery, I told you, right colic artery here, it supplies the ascending colon, correct? Then the branches of ileocolic artery supply blood to the distal ileum, the last part of the ileum of small intestine, the valve which connects the ileum and the cecum itself, and most importantly, the vermiform appendix, and a small part of proximal ascending colon, which I showed you here. So the supply in order is celiac artery supplies the small intestine, which we can't see here. Then we have the superior mesenteric artery's branches. First we have the ileocelial artery supplying the distal ileum, the cecum, the vermiform appendix, and the proximal part of the ascending colon. Most of the ascending colon is then supplied by right colic artery, and the two-thirds of the transverse colon is supplied by middle colic artery, which is again a branch of superior mesenteric artery. Then the two-thirds of the transverse colon remaining is supplied by marginal artery, and then we have the inferior mesenteric artery's branches, the left colic artery supplying the descending colon, and the sigmoid branches supplying the sigmoid colon. So I think that covers. Now we have a simple question of anatomy from ortho. So there are three separate bones connected with the cartilage in the area of pelvic cavity, and these bones are noticed on the x-ray. So they are just asking the names of these bones. So we all know the bones of the pelvic girdle are three. They are the left and right hip bones, which are irregularly shaped bones that form the part of the pelvic girdle. Now the hip bone, each left and right hip bone is composed of three parts. The big ilium, the yellow part here is the pubis, and the green part here is the ischium other names are iliac, pubis and sciatic. So these bones are joined by cartilage here, and these are the bones of the pelvic girdle. All you need to know is the names of these bones in this question: ilium or iliac, the pubis, and the ischium or the sciatic. That's all. Okay, the next question we have here is from histology. A 60-year-old patient has reduced perception of high frequency sounds. So what structure disorder of auditory analyzer caused these changes? So in this question, what you need to notice or observe is that the sound perception disorder is of high frequency sound. So there are high frequency sounds, there are low frequency sounds, and there are the middle frequency sounds. Correct. So what happens in the ear is that the different structure of the auditory analyzer are responsible for analyzing different frequencies of the sounds. So in case of high frequency sounds, the main membrane of the cochlea near the oval window is the part responsible. In case of low frequency sounds, the main membrane of the cochlea near the helicoderma is responsible. And then in case of the middle frequency, the main membrane of the cochlea in between these two is responsible. So we are done with first 10 questions of the BASED. A slow start, but we'll try to pick up the pace in the next video. This pace will be divided in various videos, various parts. So make sure you subscribe the channel to get the notifications of all the remaining parts of the BASED. And we'll try to pick up the pace in the next videos. And if you like this video and found it helpful, please subscribe the channel and share this video with your friends so that they can also take advantage of this analysis of the basic concepts of the anatomy, which can help to score good marks in CROC exam. So this is Pirates of Caribbean. It's been good, and see you in the next one. Goodbye.